Mr. Ambassador, you spoke to an extremely appreciative audience last evening of students, I think one of the most appreciative that I've seen since I've been at Duke University. And a colleague of mine, a retired colleague who had been in the Polish Foreign Service and who had been the chief negotiator of the Mutual Security Treaty between Britain and Canada, speaking from a foreign point of view, was very, very complimentary about your speech.
Well, I'm very pleased, Dr. Cole. One never knows how things are going to go, but I'm glad there was it was appreciated.
I wonder, for this slightly different audience, if you would be willing to mention or summarize one or two of the main points that you made in your speech last evening.
Well, I think, to my mind, there are the two most important elements in negotiation. First, a knowledge of your country's interests, and a thorough knowledge of what they are and why they are such. And the second is integrity, almost as almost equal importance, I would say. And those are the two things that I think I would put at the top of the qualities needed for a successful negotiation or diplomacy. As I mentioned in my talk last night, this was the case in my dealings with Faisal in Saudi Arabia, who I'm quite sure would not have agreed to accept my proposal had he not had confidence in me, because he was very distrustful of Nasser and very tough and thought he had Nasser at a disadvantage, and because Nasser had gotten bogged down in Yemen, he had so many troops there that he was pretty powerless vis-a-vis Israel. So he was really anxious to get out, and Faisal knew that, and I think wouldn't have signed up unless he thought that we would carry through on our commitments. So that I do think that. Then I think, of course, perceptiveness too, as I mentioned, a feeling for the other side's problems and positions. What is important to them, what is most important, or what is of secondary importance. Sensitivity to the feelings, the attitude of the other side. And as I mentioned in my talk, one often finds a difference in the delegation. I mean, some tougher than others, some harder, some more anxious to come to agreement. This too I found in the negotiations with Panama, where there were, I think, usually seven, sometimes eight on their side, and one did find differences in the attitudes of those who are on the opposite side. And the opportunity to exploit that situation is important if you are sensitive to it and perceptive enough. I think you can make good use of it.
I wonder if I might ask a question about the integrity angle and cite a case. During the World War II, the Swedish government had a treaty arrangement with the Nazi Germany to provide for transit traffic through southern Sweden.
Oh, yes.
These agreements were very, very fundamentally violated, and we had complete information on the extent of these violations. There were later negotiations dealing with these matters in which Swedish representatives and diplomats were involved. We knew that the Swedish government was informed and these diplomats were informed of this falsification that we were receiving. Mm. My question is, to what extent is the diplomat himself completely bound, let's say, by national policy or national interests in a situation where the facts themselves are inaccurate and where the diplomat himself is acquainted with these inaccuracies?
That's a very difficult question. I don't think I've ever run into a situation of that kind, particularly. I think the question of national interest is foremost, and I think the diplomat has to be guided by that fact, and he may have to make exceptions, perhaps, to a situation of that kind.
Mr. Ambassador, there have been a number of writers in international relations who have maintained that revolution in communications has altered the position of the diplomat and the ambassador, and have reduced, in effect, his role as a negotiator and initiator to more of a transmitter of information. Now, last evening, you referred to the fact that during your negotiations with President Tu in Vietnam, you were in constant communication, telephonic and telegraphic, with Washington. To what extent would you agree with this these allegations? I would assume that, from the tenor of your excellent speech, that you would not be in agreement with this feeling that the role of the diplomat has been reduced, but...
That's correct, Dr. Kaur. I am not in agreement with it. I think the, in fact, I think the development of rapid communication has increased the effectiveness of the diplomat.
Yes.
Because he is able to get opinions promptly. And this was certainly true in Vietnam, where I was, I mentioned this 72-hour period when I had 5 hours of sleep, but I was a good part of much of the time on the telephone, or sending priority messages back and forth to Washington and being able to get the answers.
Yes.
So that I think it's enhanced rather than detracted from it. It's also made it more difficult in a way because there's much more pressure from the press and from the correspondents to get information and try to try to worm it out of you in some way or other. But it is... Certainly the rapidity of communications, I think, is helpful.
Could you recall any major instance in which some American policy was altered as a result of recommendations initiated from the field when you were ambassador?
Oh, yes, I had, I don't know that I can cite any specific instances, but certainly, I had direct access to the president when I was there, and the president insisted that I send him weekly messages of my own through back channels, not through the department, which I did, and had to spend really one day a week and sent usually often 20-page message or 30-page message back to the president on the development.
Which president was this?
This is President Johnson, and yes. Followed with President Nixon.
Yes.
Though as time went on, with President Nixon, I got first biweekly and then monthly, but I think I had my messages were all numbered, of course, and I think I transmitted 96 presidential messages while I was there directly to the White House. So that I could get a response to these in due course. I can remember one instance when Clark Clifford, who was then Minister of Defense, Secretary of Defense, came to Saigon and urged me to send a message to the president suggesting that we try to get into negotiations right away and time to pull out our troops. And I did not agree with him and said so to the president. I thought at that time, had we pulled out then, South Vietnam would have collapsed. And the president did support me in that. Another instance.
Could you give me the date of that? Was that in
68?
68, yes.
Now, another instance where I did not succeed, where I tried, in 67.
Yes.
June 67, I sent a message to the president suggesting that we go into Laos and cut the Ho Chi Minh Trail on the theory that if we cut off infiltration of personnel and of supplies, the Viet Cong would wither on the vine, that they were only kept alive because of supplies, personnel coming down from the north. I was turned down on that for three reasons. First, that it would be a violation of our agreement on Laotian neutrality. Secondly, fearful of China's reaction. Third, that it would take two or three more divisions. My response was that it was quite true, it was a violation of Laotian neutrality, but the other side had never observed it. From the day they signed the agreement on neutrality in 62, they had kept on infiltrating and sending down supplies, and that it probably our intervention probably would have been welcomed by the Laotians. Secondly, while we had no relations with Communist China, we did have good friends at Peking, the British, the French, and others who could make it clear to Peking that we had no designs on China, or on the government in North Vietnam. All we were doing was resisting aggression. And third, it's true it would have taken a couple of more divisions, but we sent them in anyway in the long run. But I was turned down on those grounds, so that I wasn't successful in that case.
Might I ask, is this a matter of public record, or is this?
No.
This would be a bit of addition to history, would it not?
Yes.
Here? Yes.
Yeah. It's not a matter of public record.
Yes.
And my message is still, of course, classified.
Yes.
But I felt we could have shortened the war. There are other things we might have done too, I think, that might have shortened the war that we didn't do.
I would gather that you don't agree with Woodrow Wilson's open covenants openly arrived at, which perhaps he violated first of all, but judging from your speech, this would... You would not agree with that, am
no,
I correct,
decidedly.
Mr. Ambassador?
That's quite right. Decidedly not. I had, case I mentioned, dispute over West New Guinea or West Irian between the Dutch and the Indonesians. I took them out to borrow a house out in Middleburg, Virginia, and we went and lived there and stayed there all the time we were negotiating. Sometimes we had to break up. They had to go back and get instructions from their governments, but we always returned there, and the press never knew where we were. And I think it had been very difficult. Feelings ran pretty high on both sides at times. And the same thing is true in of course, with Faisal and Nasser, there wasn't a problem. I talked to each one individually. Did this shuttle diplomacy in DC-3 in those days, and in Panama when we went to Panama for negotiations, we didn't stay in Panama City. We went off to an island in the Pacific, in the Pearl Islands called Contadora. Well, we were away from where communication, even with our own people, was very difficult. So I don't think The prime example, I think, was what I cited last night, and that is that the negotiations at the Hotel Majestic in Paris on the Vietnam War. And I think, because the Vietnamese simply wanted to pressure American opinion and use it as a propaganda vehicle. So although we had very able negotiators there, nothing ever came out of it until Kissinger negotiated secretly.
You mentioned this matter last evening, but if one could refer to the post-Camp David difficulties and the remark that the President Carter is supposed to have made yesterday, that remaining differences between Egypt and Israel are insignificant and it's almost disgusting. Would you attribute some of these problems to the lack of secrecy in the negotiations?
Well, I think so, yes. And of course, I can understand the President's exasperation.
Yes.
I've been in that position myself. But I think it was a mistake. Well, as it turned out, obviously, but I thought at the time it was a mistake to say that the agreement was going to be signed on December 17th. That's always dangerous, because you never know what can turn up at the last minute in these negotiations. And while these may seem insignificant to the President, probably are from my point of view, they may be very significant to the Egyptians or to the Israelis. For example, just the question in the Vietnamese negotiations, the question of procedure really became a question of substance, the shape of the table. It meant recognition or not recognition of the Viet Cong by the other side. That was a matter of substance to them. And not just procedure. We were, on our side, we got exasperated with this shape of the table. For heaven's sakes, let's get on with the job. But not to them. Another thing, I think, and I understand the reason for the President being so optimistic at the time. It was a very substantial achievement, I think, to bring them together and to get as far as he did. But it's one thing to, I think I mentioned last night, it's one thing to develop guidelines, a framework for a negotiation. It's another thing to implement it. Now, the first thing, when I took over the negotiations with Panama, the first thing I did was to work out with them a set of principles, 8 points, which would serve as guidelines for the negotiation. And Kissinger went to Panama and signed these with their foreign minister. Well, it took us 4 years to flesh out the framework. And this is what's happening, of course, in the case of the Egyptians and the Israelis. And what seem to us minor points can be very important to them. I don't know, happen to know what they are, but certainly I know that what seem to us in many cases minor have been very important to others. Just this question, I mentioned the question of flying flags. It was terribly important to the Dutch. You know, the agreement which we had signed could have been founded on the whole thing.
Mr. Ambassador, you've mentioned your direct relationships when you were in diplomatic post with at least two of the presidents, President Johnson and President Nixon. But you served under seven presidents, four Democratic presidents and three Republican presidents.
Yes.
I wonder if you would be willing to comment on your relationships with other of these presidents, perhaps the extent to which they wish to direct you to your activities and any other aspects of their style, shall we say, and their relationships with you.
Yes, as I mentioned, I think in one of my other interviews, I came into government through Dean Acheson, and we'd been in college together. He was a year ahead of me at Yale, and had kept in touch through the years. In fact, he was a partner in the firm of Covington and Burling in Washington, and I retained him in a number of cases that we had. We kept in close touch. And he wanted, we were having a lot of trouble with Perón at the time, and he wanted somebody who knew the Latins and could speak Spanish to go to Argentina. Well, the major part of my business career was in sugar, and had I had interest in the United States, but also in Mexico and Cuba and Puerto Rico, Colombia. So I've had a good many years of dealings with them, and as I'd been in business then for 34 years, I decided that I'd try it out, never expecting to continue in government. But he asked me to see President Truman, and the dean at that time was having a good deal of trouble with the Congress. I said to the president that I thought Dean was doing a splendid job, and I was sorry to see he was having so much trouble. And I said I hadn't always admired him as I did now. He coached the freshman crew when I was a freshman. I didn't have great confidence in his coaching, and still less when he threw me off the crew. The president said, "How do you know? Perhaps he showed his good judgment even then." And he said, "Well, it's too bad." He said, "You know, we try to get good men to come into government. They come in at a great financial sacrifice, and then they're subject to all kind of abuse." And he said, "Of course, as for me, I'm abuse proof." And he said, "The fact is, when I was vice president, I had never been invited by President Roosevelt to sit in at a cabinet meeting. I became president without ever having attended a cabinet meeting, and consequently was at a loss for a great many things that I ought to have known about." And he said, "I changed that right away." And Dean asked me to go to Italy while I was in Argentina, and I came back, and he asked me to go and see Mr. Truman again and to get my instructions. So I went to see him, and he said, "Well, Mr. Bunker," he said, "I haven't much to give you in the way of instructions, but I want you to get close to the Pope." He said, "I'm a hard-shell Baptist from the Bible Belt, but these bigots won't let me send an ambassador to the Vatican. The Vatican is very well informed on international affairs. So I want you to get close to the Pope." And I reported this to Dean. He said, "That's easier said than done, Ellsworth," which I discovered to be the case. But I was a great admirer of Truman's. I thought he was, it's interesting that you can hardly think of two people with more different backgrounds than Dean Acheson and Harry Truman, yet they were devoted to one another and worked very closely together and very effectively. I think Truman had great confidence in Acheson, and Acheson had great confidence and affection in Truman. And I think made an excellent combination, because Acheson, as his background and education and legal training as a Secretary of State, and Truman having served in the Senate and knowing the workings of the Congress, made an excellent team. Truman knew how to get things, legislation, through the Senate, just as Johnson did in it. The next I served then under Eisenhower. Next, I used to say I was fired by the Republicans but rehired. He asked me to go to India. And I had not seen a great deal of Eisenhower. I had been at the White House once or twice. I was, in the interim period, president of the American Red Cross, and I'd been there for dinners, but and sometime once a fairly small affair, but I hadn't really had a great deal of contact with him, but did found him very man of great charm, really. And he came to India when I was there, had the most tremendous reception, I think, that anybody has ever had in India. Part of the reason being that, well, our relations had improved, but it was just after the Chinese incursion into Indian territory in 59, when we came to their assistance. And I was able to get for them very quickly 27 C-119s, which they were in desperate need of to get supplies to the border, and this had a great effect. And I remember Mr. Nehru and the President of India, Prasad, and I barely got to the airport in time to meet the President because of the crowds and the traffic. I had to get out and walk to get to the airport. Finally got picked up by two young girls in a Volkswagen and just made it. And they took the President in a long way around, long route in to the center of New Delhi, Connaught Circus, where the procession just bogged down, crowded in. Mr. Nehru got out of the car and joined the police to clear the way. And President was there for several days, and he, at the last day, spoke with Mr. Nehru at the fairgrounds between the old and new cities, and police estimated there were some 800,000 people there, and about 1 million people coming in. So it was really a great triumph for him.
Did he give you, if I might ask, any instructions of the type that Mr. Truman had given you?
No, he didn't. I went to see him, of course, and he said, you do the best you can. You know what, we're trying to improve our relations with the Indians and with India. And and nor did Foster Dulles either. He and I were old friends, but he didn't give me any special instructions. Said, just go out and do what you can. And of course, President Johnson, well, President Kennedy, I had known him when he was in the Senate. And I was in India when he was elected. And the post had been India. Kenneth Galbraith wanted the post as ambassador to India, and was very active in the campaign, had been promised the post, so, and we are old friends, and Vermont neighbors, as a matter of fact, and so he wrote me about it, said he was coming out, and I went back, again, expecting to retire. Well, I did retire, actually. President and Kennedy asked me if I would become Assistant Secretary for Latin American Affairs, and I said I couldn't do it because of my wife's health. But he did ask me to go out on the first to take up the West New Guinea thing, and between the Dutch Indonesians, and then the Yemen proposal, and then. And of course he died. And
did you have his full support at all times?
Oh yes, mm-hmm. I had full support. Yes. Couldn't have been better.
Yes.
And then I retired again, and Johnson asked me to become ambassador to the Organization of American States. And there were no special instructions there, of course, because it's one of these ongoing things. But I was very fond of Johnson and always had tremendous support from him. He But he's very impetuous too, in many ways. You know, he and impatient about getting things wound up. I remember when I was in the Dominican Republic trying to work out a settlement between the government and the constitutionalistas. I would get calls from Bill Bowdler, who was later an ambassador, you know, who was in the NSC, almost daily asking me what progress we were making. And I remember one call I got from him in August, I think it was, saying the president was going to speak on Pan-American Day and he'd like to announce the settlement. I said, you tell the president, Bill, he hasn't got a chance of announcing it. And, I always had my relations with him couldn't have been better, and I always had a very strong support.
On this matter of timing, which you've considered so important in your lecture, he was not always consonant with the needs of the occasion.
That's right. That's right. No, but he's a very human person, and yeah. And you know, because of his experience in the Congress, he really got more legislation through in his term than all his predecessors on human rights, civil rights. I think someday it'll be recognized, I hope, because of Vietnam it's been forgotten. But he was very human, and I, after I finished my tour in the OAS, he appointed me ambassador at large and asked me to go to the Middle East, you know, to see what we could do about this whole problem of water, Israel, Jordan, and all that part of the Middle East. Well, I went out there, made one trip only, and then I went to Kathmandu. I was married there, and I had to go to Buenos Aires to head our delegation. Dean Rusk, who was secretary, had to go back to Washington, sent word to me, asked me to come to Buenos Aires, which I did, and then from there I had a message from him saying he'd like to see me when I returned. And he said, I returned on a Saturday, he said, the president's in Texas, but he wants to see you on Tuesday when he gets back, but I'll forewarn you, he wants you to go to Vietnam. So I went to see the president, and he said, well, I want you to, I said, I want you to go to Vietnam. It's the most important thing now facing us in foreign situation, foreign affairs. Well, I said, Mr. President, you've just appointed me ambassador at large. I've just been married, and I've got to consult my wife. He said, that's right. You must consult Carol. He said, I'll give you a plane. You go out to Kathmandu and then meet me in Guam. So, this is the way, I mean, characteristic of Johnson.
You mentioned last evening, Mr. Ambassador, that you had laid down certain guidelines that were to be operative in your negotiations on the Panama Canal Treaty and had the approval of the president. How did you arrive at those guidelines, shall I say, and how did you get the approval of the president? Was this done directly with the president or with the Secretary of State or...
No, I negotiated and our side with the Panamanian side, worked out the set of principles. There were 8 principles. I don't know that I can enumerate them all from memory, but providing that we would negotiate a new treaty, which had been agreed to. You see, these negotiations covered a period of 14 years in Panama. 64, when I was at the OAS, we had the troubles there, and Panama broke relations with us. And the matter then was referred to the OAS, to the Peace Committee. And I think we had some 27 drafts of resolutions, and neither unacceptable to one side or the other. So I got hold of I said to the Panamanian ambassador, I think the best only thing for us to do is to get off by ourselves and see if we can't work out something. So we got away. Again, secret diplomacy. We met between meals at a lunch club in Washington. That agreement worked out and was accepted by both the Panamanian president and President Johnson, and resumed negotiations, and then agreed to negotiate a new treaty. That was in 64, then 65. And Robert Anderson, who had been Secretary of the Treasury, was appointed chief negotiator, and kept on for 9 years, I guess. Summer of 73, he resigned, and the president, I came back then from Vietnam, the president asked me to take it on. So it wasn't till 77 that we got the agreement signed, and of course not till 78 till it was finally ratified. So it was a long process. But we worked out this set of principles. First, providing for a new treaty. Secondly, restoration of sovereignty to Panama promptly. Providing a termination date to the new treaty. And providing an agreement, providing to negotiate an agreement on neutrality, permanent neutrality of the treaty. And providing for the prompt return of sovereignty to Panama, of the whole zone, of the zone. Well, I've forgotten what the other details of it, but anyway, Mr. Nixon was then president, of course, and I had no problem, as far as he was concerned.
Did you have a written or oral authorization from Mr. Nixon?
Oral. And the question, of course, arose whether the new administration would continue under the same principles, guidelines. And I talked to Mr. Vance about it. Recommended that we go ahead on the same guidelines. We had made a great deal of progress, actually, I suppose, on at least half the issues by the time the new administration took over. We didn't make much progress in 76 because of the political campaign. It, as you recall, became an issue in the political campaign. And Mr. Reagan, I think, won the Texas primaries on the issue of the Panama Canal Treaty. It became an issue in the New Hampshire primaries when he was there, and he told me, he said, I never thought of bringing it up, but he said it came up in New Hampshire, and he said, so there was a good deal of concern about it. And he said, so I got interested in it, took hold of it, and he used it very effectively in several places. But I thought we had made so much progress, and if we had to start all over again, we'd have certainly difficulties with the Panamanians, who were getting pretty impatient after 10 years. And he agreed that we should go along, and the president also agreed. So we continued under the same guidelines.
Mr. Ambassador, you have not only served under 7 presidents, but you've served under 7 secretaries of state. And, or at any rate, there have been 7 secretaries of state in office since you've held your first ambassadorial appointment. I wonder if you would care to comment on your relationships with any one or two of those. You've mentioned Mr. Dulles. Mr. Kissinger would be of interest. He has been charged by some as dealing directly with foreign governments and avoiding relationships through the regular embassy. Did you have this experience with Mr. Kissinger?
Not in Vietnam. Yes. No. I dealt with him very closely and very personally in the Vietnam situation. I never had. He came out twice while I was there. To talk to Tu, but I never had a problem of his going over my head or trying to deal directly. And of course, I was always with him when he was talking with Tu. But I as far as I was concerned, I couldn't have had a better relationship than I had with Kissinger, or stronger support. And as a matter of fact, when I came back from Vietnam, in addition to taking on the Panama negotiations, he asked me to serve as co-chairman of the Geneva Conference, which I did at the same time, concurrently, with my Russian colleague. And did have to go to Geneva from time to time, but had to go on all the shuttle trips with him through the Middle East, so that I saw a great deal of him during that period. He was constantly on the move, and it was a pretty rugged exercise, I may say, because while the secretary had a bedroom, the rest of us didn't. So we snatched our sleep when we could. But I was, of course, a tremendous admirer of his ability. And on those occasions, he did deal with the heads of government, Mrs. Mayer in Israel, President Sadat, President of Syria, King of Jordan, with Faisal in Saudi Arabia, and but we were always with him. I mean, he didn't do it alone. He didn't do it on his own. I was always present, and Joe Sisko, who was assistant secretary then, was always with him, and I think he'd. Like Dean Acheson, he didn't suffer fools gladly, and always made it rather evident at times, I think. But was in a sense a lone operator in that on policy matters. I think he had a tendency, perhaps more than some of the other secretaries, to go on his own rather than taking advice from his experts in whatever field he was dealing in, and not I think the rank and file of the Foreign Service found him not an easy person to work with, but did admire him nevertheless, admired his ability, but didn't find him personally as easy to work with as some of the other secretaries. As, for example, Dean Rusk, who had a much easier manner, and did rely more on his subordinates.
Would you say the same would be true of Secretary Vance?
Yes, I think so. I see a good many similarities between Dean Rusk and Cy Vance. I think Batts is a very easy person to work with, and has a very agreeable, easy personality. I mean, makes one feel at home at once. But I think Kissinger had a tendency to frighten some people around him. And of course, Foster Dulles too was a very reserved, rather austere individual. I've never had any problems with him. We always worked together very well. I'd known him for years, and both Foster and Alan Dulles, and so that, and he never really gave me any instructions. First asked me to go as a delegate to the General Assembly and then to India. But there again, I think the Dean Acheson and Foster Dulles both, you might say, ran foreign policy. I think Eisenhower let Foster Dulles run foreign policy and wasn't especially interested in it. And Kissinger, I think, ran foreign policy too in the Nixon administration. Well, he really ran it when he was at the White House and before he became Secretary of State.
Is there some advantage in that? Sometimes one hears that there may be differences between Mr. Brzezinski and Mr. Vance at the present time, and that creates difficulties. Has this been your experience?
It was not my experience when Kissinger was at the White House, because I think Bill Rogers was content to let the situation go along that way, drift that way, and I'm not sure that that's true in the present situation. I never had any problems during the Nixon administration as between Nixon and Rogers, but it was quite clear that I think Kissinger was calling the tunes. Now, I don't know the situation. I just what I hear, read in the press about possibility of differences between Vance and Brzezinski, but I don't know how serious they are, if there are any, really.
I wonder if I could ask two rather brief questions, Mr. Ambassador. You have been linked with Averell Harriman and David Bruce as perhaps being the three deans of the diplomatic corps since World War II, and for good reason. Would you be willing to comment on the factors which you think might have made for your mutual success?
Well, I don't know what they are, really. I've certainly been most compatible friendships with both David Bruce and Averell Harriman. Averell was a senior at Yale when I was a freshman. I mentioned Dean Acheson's coaching the freshman crew. We were then decided to go Simon Pure amateur, and Averell coached the varsity crew. I regret to say we had a disastrous defeat by Harvard at that point and returned to professionals. But I think Averell's later career as a professional, both politician and diplomat and negotiator, was very, very impressive. And we worked together. He was assistant secretary for Eastern Affairs when I negotiated the new West Irian thing, and so we worked very closely there together, and very congenially always. And David Bruce I'd known over the years, but of course our posts were varied and we didn't see so much of one another, but he did come out with me to Saigon when he agreed to go to Paris as a chief negotiator there, and stayed with me, and I'd known him over the years, and we were very close friends, and I don't know what it's hard for me to say what qualities.
Would you say successful business experience in all three of these instances might have contributed to effectiveness in the diplomatic field?
Well, I think perhaps so. I think my business experience was of use. I, particularly in negotiation, I had my younger days had labor problems. I had many negotiations with labor unions. And they're pretty difficult to negotiate with at times, I found. And also, I think economic aspects of diplomacy have become increasingly important, and particularly as the world has become interdependent to such a degree that the economies of countries come so strongly into our relations with them, and beginning with the Marshall Plan in Europe, where we build up the European economies, I mean, enable them to come back, and a good deal of my dealings in Italy, for example, were on the economic aspects, the Marshall Plan aid, and this sort of thing that we were taking care of. So that I think that business experience experience in economics training is an important part of diplomacy today.
Would you say that financial independence would be a contributing factor here?
Well, in some posts, unfortunately, yes. And I think I'm sorry to say so. But there are some posts where one has to have independent means, like London, Paris, Rome, and our diplomatic allowances are inadequate representation allowances, in my opinion, for posts of that kind. For example, when I first went to Italy, Llewellyn Thompson was my deputy, and I had a great admirer of his. Then Claire Luce followed me, and Tommy Thompson went to Austria as High Commissioner during the occupation was still on then. And he wrote to me once and said that he understood that some report that he wanted Claire's position in Rome, and he said, please make it clear that I can't afford it, can't take it. Well, that's a very tragic situation when a man of his preeminent ability can't take a post in Rome or London or somewhere of that kind. The British do it quite differently. They don't pay large salaries, but they give very adequate representation allowances. I think in Rome, for example, where every 4th of July you have to give a big reception for all the American community and everybody else. I think our fiscal year begins July 1. Did at that time, and I think I used my entire allowance on July 4th. And so it's not a healthy situation. It ought to be available to a Foreign Service officer with experience like Llewellyn Thompson, anybody else.
Well, I noticed that all three of you, with slight modification for Mr. Bruce, started at the top. That is, in the top diplomatic service. And again, is this an advantage? I suppose my question, put differently, is to what extent does career service in the Foreign Service operate advantageously or disadvantageously in the training of individuals for these especially important diplomatic assignments and accomplishments?
Oh, I think it operates advantageously. By and large, we have very able career diplomats, foreign service people, and I wouldn't pretend that I could have been successful without the kind of support I had from the professional service. I had magnificent support from them everywhere I went, and I ascribe what success I may have had very largely to the kind of assistance I had from the career service. And I'm all for promoting the career service, and I think we've made some pretty bad appointments from the non-career service, many posts, for purely political reasons. So that I'm a strong backer of the professional service.
I wonder if I could ask one final question, Mr. Ambassador, from the point of view of a member of the faculty at Duke University. What advice would you offer, in the light of your very extensive experience, to a young Foreign Service officer or a potential Foreign Service officer who is doing his work in a university? Would you encourage him to study languages? Would you encourage him to acquire depth in some area? Or is there any advice that one can offer? You've had such varied experience in so many different posts that you might comment on this.
Well, I think, yes. Two studies, I think, aside from languages, of course, the ability to master languages is important, I think, and it's important that we try to send people who speak the language of the country. And so often, particularly in political appointments, we don't do that, naturally. But that's important. Facility in language is important. I think history is an important study, as giving background, a broader sweep of history. And economics is important, because, as I mentioned just now, economics has become such an important part of foreign relations that I think that is also helpful. I would say perhaps those three elements are the really important factors in preparation for foreign service.
Did you ever offer any special advice to young foreign service officers who were coming in and serving under you?
Well, I can't remember specific instances, but I know I've been asked for advice, and I can't cite an exact case, but yes, I have had them come to me and ask for advice on, for example, when they've been offered a post, whether they should accept that post or not, or whether I thought they were qualified for it, or what would be involved in it. And some of them have come to me to ask whether they should continue in the Foreign Service. Sometimes they get a bit discouraged about don't get ahead as fast as they think they ought to get ahead, what their problems are, what I think their problems are, and not getting ahead faster, things of that kind. And
encourage them to stay on, did you?
Yes, I think in most cases, yes. I think in one or two cases I advised them not to stay on, because I really thought that their chances of promotion were not as good as they might be, and they might do better outside in some other field. And some of them have done actually very well outside the field, and But by and large, when they are people of capacity and intelligence and with good personalities, which is important too in dealing with foreign nationals, I've advised them to stay in.